So we are Vlad and
Lana. Hi guys.
Wanted to take a moment and talk to you about the importance and some practical tips on overcoming discouragement, burnout, and perhaps depression as well. Mm-hmm. And so we know that from the scripture that anxiety, depression, discouragement, a lot of times it comes from three sources. The first source is the sin. We know that when Samson, he committed sin, he lost his power. The second one is from serving. When a woman touched Jesus, the Bible says that power mm-hmm. left him. Sometimes you serve a lot and you get burned out, or you get discouraged mm-hmm. after that. And the third one is actually Satan, because it is the devil's goal to bring distress. The scripture says that King Saul had a distressing spirit. I believe there are spirits that are released to bring stress, anxiety, depression, burnout, discouragement, yeah. to dishonor courage. Mm-hmm. And so the first tip that I would encourage anybody who's going through that is to re-anchor yourself in your identity in Jesus. A lot of things that we do, I feel like, it's to find who we are. And we start out well by finding ourselves in Christ. But with time, we drift, we shift our perspective to begin to draw our identity from work, accomplishments, our appearance, our failures, people's opinions, or all of the other things that are extra, that is like a sand. Because the Bible says the man who built his house on the sand, everything was fine. He built it quickly until the storm came. And sometimes when a storm comes in the form of a testing or in the form of promotion, and we just fall apart because our foundation, our identity is not anchored in Jesus.
Yeah, and many times we can lose that anchorness, if I can say like that, mm-hmm. in Jesus Christ, and turn our eyes or our hearts towards something else to draw our identity from. And I just want to read Hebrews 12, and the Bible says that, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, mm-hmm. and let us run with endurance the grace, the race that mm-hmm. God has set before us. And so everything that weighs us down is like anything that we don't anchor, anything, if we don't anchor our identity in Jesus Christ, it becomes like a stone in our hearts that slows us down, that weights us down. Like if it's an accomplishment or something, or every insecurity, if we are comparison, and those things, they are not necessarily sin, but they're like a weight, like a stone in our mm-hmm. heart, that slows us down to run the race, to live for Jesus Christ. And but when we set our identity and draw our worth from mm-hmm. Jesus, mm-hmm. we need to remove every single insecurity and kind of just refocus our, refocus ourselves to where our identity comes from. And it's only, and it has to come only from Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm.
That's so true, because Paul, or the author of Hebrews, he said that to lay aside every weight, and that weight, and then he says sin. So sometimes the weight is anything we place our worth in that's not Jesus, mm-hmm. becomes the weight. Those things in themselves are good. Be good looking is good. Accomplishments are good. Success is good. Money is good. People's opinions are good, but it cannot be where you draw your identity from, because when you do, it brings discouragement, it will bring depression, it will bring anxiety, it will bring pride, it will bring all of those things that will destroy us eventually. Yeah. And so the first thing that I would encourage you with is to go back and to anchor yourself in Jesus. Anchor yourself in Christ. Paul says so many times in the Gospels, he says that in epistles, in Christ, in Him, in Him, in Him. Because Christian life, we are defined by Jesus. Mm-hmm. We're not defined by our job. Yeah. We're not defined by our past. We're not defined by our appearance. We're not defined by how many followers we have. What people think of us, that doesn't define us.
Yeah.
We're defined
because
by Jesus.
Because I feel like anytime we will define ourselves, for example, by opinions of people, that means if they have a good opinion about us, our head is going to grow this big. We're going to become so mm-hmm. prideful. But next day, they're going to have a low opinion about us, and then we're going to literally die and have mm-hmm. a headache and fall into depression, insecurity. And those things, they just cannot become a base foundation for our identity. Mm-hmm.
The second thing that I would encourage everyone facing discouragement right now or facing anxiety or depression, and that is to examine your consciousness and live with pure consciousness. Because let's be honest, the thing that brings a lot of anxiety, a lot of depression and discouragement is an open door called sin. When people live in sin, see, when Samson had the power,
mm-hmm.
he lost the power when he started to compromise. And when we begin to compromise, we lose our strength, we lose our passion, we lose the courage that we have in Christ. And so Paul even says, he says that some people have ignored their consciousness and they suffered shipwreck
in their faith.
Their faith is destroyed. What is your faith? It's positive substance. It's this confidence inside. It's that joy inside. It's that optimism. And people have a shipwreck, meaning their inner world is falling apart because
that's
the consciousness
true.
Is like the ship.
Yeah, it's true. When we don't follow our consciousness and go against that gut feeling, you know, that don't do this or do this. If we constantly ignore our consciousness, it eventually will destroy our faith, and we will be so discouraged, won't be able to pray, we will not find strength to open our Bible and read the Bible, follow Jesus, and our inner world will fall apart, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
It's true.
And you have to ask yourself, what is the last thing that God asked me to do that I've been ignoring? What is the last thing that God has asked of me to do that I've been putting it off? Because that, my friend, is the key to courage. Discouragement is something that's dissing on your courage. And you know what that diss is? It's disobedience. Disobedience will diss on your courage. You find discouragement. And so because in holiness is righteousness and strength and power.
Yeah.
So the first thing is anchor yourself in Jesus. Number two is keep your consciousness clear. Watch for your consciousness. Always protect your consciousness so it stays pure and holy. The third thing is avoid a comparison trap. It's the 10th commandment that thou shall not covet. Meaning, it's okay to look up to people and learn from them.
Mm-hmm.
But when you make it your mission and your goal, and your happiness depends on being better than somebody else, competing, then you're not complete.
Yeah.
And what competition does and what comparison does is it leads you to complaining. It leads you to coveting. And then it self-destructs you. It destroys you because you no longer can be yourself. You no longer can celebrate other people. You're constantly competing with other people. You can't weep with those who weep because you rejoice in their sorrow because you find identity in being better than them.
Yeah.
You can't rejoice with somebody who rejoices when they're succeeding. You're suffering.
And becoming insecure.
Yeah, you can't take somebody's success. You can't learn from anybody. And you can't help somebody when they're struggling because you derive joy in them doing bad. You derive happiness in them failing. And then you derive disappointment in them succeeding. And that in itself is such a painful, painful way to live.
Yeah.
And with the invention of Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, and Snapchat, and YouTube, it's becoming more and more harder to be yourself, to not compare.
Yeah, and people constantly trying to be like somebody else. And if they cannot reach that goal, they're depressed. They're destroyed inside. And it's so destructive.
Mm-hmm.
It's true.
Nobody posts on Instagram their failures.
No, almost nobody.
Nobody uploads their weaknesses.
Yeah.
And nobody projects their struggles.
Mm-hmm.
If you watch our Facebook and our Instagram, we don't post the challenges we go through. And
it's the happy moments.
It's the best smiles. It's
the things. Best angles.
Best angles. And so you got to understand is that social media is one big lie. That's all it is. And my social media is half of it is a lie too. That's not how we live. We go through stuff. We battle with things. We struggle with things. And we just don't post them. Nobody does. And then you're looking at your struggles. You compare it with what people post. And of course, you're going to be discouraged. And so the goal is to not to find our identity in that and not to live comparing, but to live being complete. I love the story of Genesis where God completes each day and he looks at that day and he says, it is good. Mm-hmm. God doesn't compare the mess on earth with what happens in heaven. Yeah. See, God lived in heaven. God lives in heaven. So in heaven, everything is perfect. God doesn't look at the earth and says, oh, this sucks compared to heaven. God looks at the earth here and says, this is good. Why? Because God wasn't comparing the earth with heaven. Those are two different realms. Each person has different gifts. Each person has different talents. They have a different assignment on this earth. Don't compare your life with someone else's.
Yeah, and I feel like when people stop comparing themselves to somebody else, they actually finally beginning to become the best they are and actually able to grow into the best they could be. But when people, you know, compare to somebody else, it closes a door. There is no opportunity for a person to shine, to become who they were supposed to be.
And when you start becoming more like you, you'll find a lot of people want to be like you.
That's true.
When you stop being other people, everyone's going to want to be you. When you're trying to be everybody else, you lose your own identification. You lose your own distinctiveness.
Yeah, and I realized that what attracts people to certain people is because those people, they actually became themselves and they're shining in who they are. Mm-hmm. And that's why this is attracts actually. But when you're copying someone or you're trying to be it repels people from you.
Some churches, you walk into a church and you could see like it's a Hillsong church. They're just copy of a Hillsong. Some is copy of Bethel. And I'm like, guys, be you. Like you go to Hunger Generation and you're like, man, this is weird, different. You can't put it.
But that's us.
Yeah, but that's because of us. And so we get criticized for that. But I'd rather be criticized for who I am than be applauded for someone I'm not. Mm-hmm. And so be yourself and you will see a lot of people would want to be like you. If you're trying to be like everybody else, you're just going to find discouragement. And because it's a competitive thing, look at your life and say, it is good. And then grow in that. Learn from others. Celebrate other people's success. Weep with others when others weep. But don't live your life getting others' approval and trying to be like someone else. Like you read the scripture, what it says that to run the race set before us. Mm-hmm. Run your race.
Yeah.
The one that
each
God set for you.
Each person has their own race to run. Yeah.
Jesus finished the ministry at the age of 33. He was able to say, I finished everything. The world wasn't saved yet. People were still not doing good. But his race was complete.
Yeah.
He didn't compare himself with other guys who lived till 120. And so so the fourth thing that I wanted to share with you is that in order to overcome a discouragement is honor the Sabbath. It's one of the commandments. The fourth commandment is to take a day off, to honor the Sabbath. And the rest of the commandments go into don't kill, don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal, and don't covet. I really believe that when we ignore the fourth commandment, that is to honor the Sabbath, if we will begin to ignore other commandments. We will begin to lie, we begin to cut corners, we begin to be jealous. Why? Because when you're not rested, you begin to do a lot of other stupid things. When you don't rest fatigue, you become arrested by fatigue. Mm-hmm. And Jesus, you know, because some people say, well, we're in the New Testament. We don't have to honor the Sabbath. Actually, you have to understand one thing about the Sabbath is that Jesus said this. He said that the Sabbath was made for a man, meaning God created the Sabbath for a man because God knew man needs rest. He commanded it because he knew man will never stop working. Mm-hmm. Man will always run themselves to the ground. Yeah. And so what do you think about the importance of
rest? No, I think it's very important to take a day of rest, at least one day throughout the whole week, and actually rest and do things that replenish your soul and things that are fun, things that are not your a regular everyday job, it's very important. Like, I really like how you mentioned that if we are physically and emotionally not rested, it's so easy for us to go into the sin, to go into the things that will break God's heart, break God, even break people's hearts. Because mm-hmm. when we are frustrated, when yeah. we are not rested, when we did not have enough sleep throughout the whole week, mm-hmm. it will mess up other people around you. That's for sure. Not only yourself, but mm-hmm. other people around you. You're going to become cranky. You're going to lose temper. You're going to be angry. And all other sins will just come alongside.
It's kind of the principle of tithing. When it's better to live a 90% of being blessed by God than 100% not being blessed mm-hmm, by God. Mm-hmm. People say, well, I have so much to do. It's the same thing with money. You say, oh, but I need to buy so many things. Yet you prioritize your money by giving 10% to God. Prioritize your life by giving one day a week to your family, to God, to yourself. Stay away from work for that 1 week. You will accomplish more with less. You know, they did a study. I heard Robert Morris mention about Chick-fil-A. You know, Chick-fil-A closes on the busiest day of the week. You know, Sunday. Families go out to eat, and it's a fast food restaurant that people will go out to eat, and they close on the day in the airports, and all the restaurants are closed. Yeah. And, you know, on the average, a fast food chain, restaurant chain, makes about $1 million a year. Chick-fil-A makes $5 million a year, being closed on the busiest day of the week. So that tells you something. When you honor God and you honor the Sabbath as a pastor, as a minister, as a woman, as a man, God created that for you.
Yeah.
A lot of people looking for deliverance, when in reality, you just need to honor the Sabbath. You know, when Elijah brought the fire and killed the prophets of Baal and everything, and then, what's her name? Jezebel. And then he ran with the horses, overpowered the horses, and brought the rain again. Jezebel sends a threat, and it spooks Elijah so bad. I mean, this guy literally mm-hmm. went over against the whole power of hell, mm-hmm. and he got threatened by one witch. What happened? How come he got so threatened? Because he was exhausted. Mm-hmm. Because he was emotionally worn out. Because he was physically worn out. And then he ran, he became suicidal. And the angel came and he gave him a good meal and Elijah slept. He gave him a mm-hmm. good meal and Elijah slept. And then he heard the whisper of God. And I really believe that when you eat good, you rest good, and start paying attention to God's whispers. Not God's loud voice, but mm-hmm. God's whispers through a devotional. Yeah. Replenishing yourself. Honestly, mm-hmm. that will heal you. Yes. Bring your courage
That's
back.
That's true. That's true. And I feel like when we like follow and uphold God's
commandments
and standards and mm-hmm. things like that, it will actually bless our lives beyond and above. Because if we stay busy, that it doesn't mean we're going to be more productive.
Yeah.
We're just going to run ourselves to the ground.
Yeah.
But with obeying God's commandment to take a day of rest, we will accomplish more.
And the fifth principle is regularly exercise. You know, me and my wife, we try to do that regularly to exercise, to take care of our health. Why do you think it's important for our emotional well-being, our spiritual well-being, to take care of our body and to exercise?
Mm-hmm. I think it's very important. Even like when I I resigned from my job and I started to work at the church with my husband. It was such a big change for me, and even emotionally and physically, my job was different than right now. And so when I started to go to the gym actually regularly, it absolutely changed my mood. It helped me to even go through this transition, because for me that was a big transition from that job to mm-hmm. working in the ministry full time. It was a big issue for me, and exercise actually helped me to kind of emotionally guide me through this stage mm-hmm. of, you know, transition. And it took me 1 year to actually snap out. And I mm-hmm. gym and exercise was actually a big deal for my emotions and my physical body. And I actually noticed that by giving energy in the gym, I had more energy back, and mm-hmm. I was more energetic, in a better mood, and health-wise, mm-hmm. and it's just a lot of benefits.
And you don't have to go to the gym to exercise. You can
dance
in your house. I mean, go for a run. Go for a walk with your
outside
dog.
Outside walks. Yeah. And
park your car a little bit further.
Anything that you enjoy. Yeah. I think the key is to find something that you actually enjoy doing it. Not something that you have to, oh my gosh, I gotta go lift weights. Mm-hmm. No, something that you enjoy, and it's going to make a difference.
Of sowing and reaping. You get power, you get power back. Number six is seek community. We have a home group, and we believe in the importance. One of the reasons why people get discouraged a lot is because they don't have friends, mm-hmm. and they don't have people that they love spending time with. I'm not talking about the forced community. I'm talking about the community that actually replenishes you. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we are like snowflakes. Snowflakes in themselves are very weak. You can put a snowflake on your hand and it will melt within seconds. The warmth of your body mm-hmm. kills a snowflake. Mm-hmm. Put snowflakes together, mm-hmm. they close down schools, flip traffic, they shut down roads, highways, they flip semi-trucks because of the power of community.
Yeah.
If you, mm-hmm. Bible says it's not good for man to be alone. A lot of people's discouragement and anxiety will be solved if they stop spending time in front of fake friends on Facebook and some distant friends on Instagram, and they actually get real friends, mm-hmm. and they get real people around their life. Two are better than one, and there's a sense of accountability, there's a sense of connection that's there. It's so important, because isolation, the devil will isolate you before he defeats you.
And I feel like it's important for some of people that loners, that don't like people, don't like to talk to people. I feel like for those people, they need to actually force themselves to find a community at first. Maybe they will not enjoy it at first, but it's going to be super beneficial, like to make good friends and put yourself out there, and it's going to be very healthy for that. So kind of like, not necessarily start with, maybe you don't have those people that you enjoy being around, and it takes for you to come out of your comfort zone to, you know, go to a home group or find a home church, and you just step out there and make yourself and surround yourself with a good company of people.
Even Jesus had friends. Lazarus, Mary, Martha. The crazy part is that Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, they were not his disciples. I think sometimes Jesus got so tired of his disciples. He went and got himself some homies, got himself some friends. I mean, can you imagine, like, Jesus spending time with people that are not necessarily following him 24/7, but they were his friends. Mm-hmm. And so, and then at the end, Jesus, you know, mentioned that he says, now I no longer call you servants, but I call you friends, meaning Jesus developed that relationship with them. I believe in power of friendships is so important. Mm-hmm. And the last thing that I would encourage you with, and this applies to pastors, this applies to parents, this applies to young people, older people, is this: a lot of discouragement and anxiety in our life comes from toxic people. Mm-hmm. You gotta remove toxic people out of your life. Even Jesus could not perform his best in the house of Jairus when his daughter was dead until he removed toxic people. When he removed them, then he healed the people. And we see that Jesus says somebody on his close circle was Judas. He betrayed him, caused him a lot of hurt, a lot of pain. And so when you have toxic people in your life, they will destroy your life. They will destroy your emotions. They will give you sleepless nights. These people, they never stop texting. They always undermine you. They always harass you. They always speak ill of you. And at the end, they will leave you. Listen to me. They're not going to change. Most toxic people don't change. They change you. They change your life. Judas didn't change. Mm-hmm. He destroyed. Put Jesus on the cross. Now, we know Jesus had to go to the cross. But which Judases do you have in your life that are currently draining energy out of you? You either need to completely disconnect from them or distance yourself from them. Give between them and you a break so that you can focus. I have probably 15 people on my phone that are blocked. Why? Because of harassment, spiritual manipulation, domination, prophetic words that are literally, that'll give me sleepless days. And until I had to say, you know what, this stops. Why? Because I need to move on. These people, the devil is sending to distract them from me. And so, and with the help of my wife, she was saying, you know, Vlad, you need to stop reading that and completely disconnect. Why? So you can focus on your destiny. I always say, if your boat is being rocked, find a Jonah and throw him overboard.
Yeah.
Oh, what's going to happen with them? Don't worry about Jonah. God has a whale for him. And I think Mariana this year, she mentioned something that I really liked. She says that there are two main things the enemy will use is isolation. And isolation says this, I'm the problem.
Mm-hmm.
No. Isolation says the people are the problem. I can't connect with people because they're the problem. And the second one is toxic people. And toxic people will always tell you that you're the problem.
You're the problem, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you're not the problem and they're not the problem. The devil is the problem. And we have to learn to run from isolation, trust, love people,
mm-hmm.
and then get rid of toxic people in our life today. Either distance yourself or completely disconnect from toxic people. And so you can fulfill your destiny and so you can find your courage once again.
Yeah.
Let's take a moment and pray right now for people who are on Facebook and people who are on YouTube and our live viewers so that God is going to minister to them. So if you can just start and just pray for people who are going through discouragement, who lost their power.
Father God, we just pray right now for people mm-hmm. who are discouraged, who are burnt out, those who are in the ministry.
Yes,
they've been serving a lot, but they have not been following your standards to take a day,
mm-hmm.
Day of rest and all other things that we mentioned, Lord. I pray for your grace right now, Lord.
God.
I pray that you will give them grace to follow through the things that they need to follow through, God, to take that day of rest, God, to replenish their soul, that they will not burn out, Lord, from ministering to people and to you, Lord. We just pray for that in Jesus' name.
Lord, I just speak courage right now
mm-hmm.
to those who are discouraged. Lord, I speak peace to those who are in the storm. I speak that there will be a realignment of their identity. I speak right now that they will get their consciousness, pure consciousness and holiness back. Lord, I speak they will honor the Sabbath. I speak they will not learn, compare themselves to others, but they will be complete in you. And Lord, I pray also in Jesus' name that you will help them to run away from isolation and help them to distance themselves from toxic people, unfollow them, block them if they need to, remove them from their life so they can focus on fulfilling their assignment in their life. I pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Thank you guys for watching. Thank you for sharing this video. Share this with your friends and be blessed in Jesus' name.
Yes, thank you guys.